Hello, good morning. You're watching Daybreak on Citizen TV this morning, the 16th of October 2018, and it's time for news review. And joined by Member of Parliament for Kiminini, Honorable Chris Omalo, and Honorable Anthony Oluoch from Mathare constituency. We are still expecting that Gunjiri Wambogo from Nyeri Town constituency will be joining us later to go through what's making headlines in the dailies and, of course, what has been informing conversations in the public and the media outlets so far. We want to start with a story that is on the Standard, front page of the Standard, talking about we are 63 members of parliament battling cancer. And, of course, that story is continued on page 6 and 7 of the same newspaper. And, of course, talking about a percentage of cancer cases diagnosed late largely due to lack of awareness and cost constraints amount to about 70%, meaning 70% of the cancer cases that are reported in the country are diagnosed late, and then the cost of treating cancer, if surgery is all that is required, is put at 500,000 shillings. And then they are saying that 30% is the percentage of cancers that is treatable if detected early in stage 1 and stage 2. And I want to begin from the point that we understand now. Honorable Waititu from Juja is saying that in Parliament there are 63 MPs, your colleagues, that are battling cancer. And yesterday we had very interesting statistics, but also shocking in the sense that now we have 47,000 new cases of cancer every year in this country, and there are 33,000 deaths related to cancer. Just how big is this situation, even as you look at it from the perspective of your colleagues in Parliament?
This is a serious matter. If you do simple statistics, if you do 63 out of the 349 members of Parliament, you can see the percentage is actually very, very high. And these are only known cases.
Right.
So I'm quite sure that the number of MPs maybe who are suffering, there might be even more. And when it comes to matters of cancer, I think the way forward is on early diagnosis. As members of parliament, we've had an opportunity to go to India for different work related. And we've always had a chance to go for that screening. Last time, I remember we were there, and you know, as men, we are more vulnerable to prostate cancer.
Yes.
So we do go for like prostate cancer, but we have other cases. Cancer can, we have the intestine, you can have the skin, whatever. So my advice is when you have an opportunity for that medical checkup, please do go for screening so that you can be able to diagnose it at an early stage. And when you diagnose it at an early stage, the chances of treatment, you know, mostly it's chemotherapy. We've had cases of radio and cases of surgery.
Right.
So for Honorable Titu, who is my actually very good friend, I think this issue has affected him. In the family, we've heard about the mother,
yes, and the sister.
And right now, Honorable Waititu is actually, when you look at him, he has really recovered. So the case that I'm saying, it is actually a reality. And you're calling upon all the Kenyans, and the, particularly the Ministry of Health, maybe they should come up with some programs that can be able to go even up to the village for the screening. Like for women, they are more susceptible to breast cancer, so that they can be able to develop a mechanism of how they can be able to predict or diagnose that early diagnosis, so that there are really high chances of survival. And you know, management of cancer right now is actually very expensive.
That's right.
I've seen many people selling land just because of the treatment.
To go for that treatment.
And then maybe our medical specialist must go to India and try to benchmark, because when you go to India, you find the management of cancer, the cost implication is actually manageable. But when you come to this country, you find it's 2 times more expensive.
That's
true. So we're asking why. So maybe benchmarking visits are very, very critical, particularly to India, where some of us have visited, we've gone through the process, and they have state-of-the-art machines and all that. Maybe we should borrow from them. Thank you.
Right, and I'm seeing some details on the newspaper just before then, just to look, to talk about what is on the screen. You see that the new cases are 37,000 per year. That's according to some older statistics of 2017, but it's according to the latest statistics, it indicates that the new cases every year are 47,000 and the deaths are at 33,000 every year. And now on the Standard, page 6, it talks about that according to the Ministry of Health, approximately 10,000 Kenyans travel abroad annually in search of treatment, spending at least 10 billion shillings. So if you do the calculation, you'll see that if 10,000 people are traveling to outside the country and they're spending 10 billion, then every person is spending an average of 1 million shillings. And I just want to talk about the cost of treatment in Kenya. But before I do that, just to welcome Ngonjeri Wambogo, Member of Parliament for Nyeri Town. Karibu sana.
Asante sana. Nyeri is far.
Kuchelewa sio kufika, sio kutofika.
Fadhali kuchelewa kuliko kukosa.
Aya, hiyo tutauliza Waswahili. But it's okay, you're joining us on this conversation about the shocking statistics that we now learn that according to Member of Parliament for Juja, that is Waititu, there are 63 members of Parliament who are battling cancer. And I was asking the question on treatment because if patients are having to travel outside the country, what then are we talking about? Why is it so hard for Kenya and the county hospitals to come up with the cancer centers that are able to treat early diagnosis and also treatment while the patients are still in the country?
Yeah, I think cancer has now become one of the leading causes of death. I think it has overtaken a lot of communicable diseases. Mm-hmm. We used to have HIV and AIDS, malaria, tuberculosis and others. I think cancer has slowly crept into one of those deadly diseases that is extremely devastating. And if you recall, mm-hmm. I think one of the members of parliament must have been Waruguru, who mm-hmm. brought a motion in parliament to have this declared as a national disaster. And indeed, I think it is a disaster. I think probably one out of every three mm-hmm. families would have a person or two who are being affected by HIV, by cancer.
Right.
I myself, my own dad is in Nairobi now. Luckily, he discovered this at stage two. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the key. The key here is about early diagnosis and constant screening.
Right.
And then even after screening, the question of management becomes an issue. It is those kind of diseases that if you do not have the ability financially, you will not be able to manage it. The amount of money that we have had to marshal in order to ensure that he gets the treatment, putting him on NHIF,
right.
getting into your pockets, and at that stage you probably don't even get insured. Mm-hmm. You remember at that advanced stage, most insurance company will be running away from giving insurance.
Yes. Yes.
But having said that, I'm looking at the cost. The number of people who go to India, mm-hmm. the amount of money that is spent in India and the foreign exchange that India earns, and I'm looking at the flip side of it in terms of medical tourism mm-hmm. and foreign exchange that would be earning. If all our counties collectively would be able to invest into cancer centers as was suggested, you can imagine the East African hub, Kenya would be the India. Mm-hmm. You'd have Rwanda, Burundi, Uganda, Tanzania, and the northern part of Africa
right.
coming to Kenya to do what we go to do to India.
Right.
And I think really this is an indictment on lost opportunities that the government ought to be looking at. And if we are thinking in terms of our agenda four, and health is one of those things, I think we really need to look at both how we can be able to cut down the cost, mm-hmm. do early screening, but also look at the medical tourism and opportunity part of it as we try to make this more affordable to our own people.
Honorable Wambogo, this is a conversation that the country has been having for quite some time now. I want to talk about since devolution took effect in 2013.
Yeah.
Do you think we've made any progress beyond just talk to actually implementing a policy framework that would ensure that the county hospitals have a capacity to handle some of these cancer cases?
Thank you very much. Again, my apologies for coming late. On whether we have made progress, yesterday I had the opportunity to visit, I had some patients at PGH, what do you call PGH, what was Provincial General Hospital in Nyeri?
Level 5.
Which is now a level 5. And I got a chance to speak to doctors, two doctors who work there. And we had a very interesting conversation. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I actually asked them to do for me a paper from their point of view about what they think the government should be doing to make universal healthcare workable. Because I think part of the problem we're having, that the conversation we're having does not have medical players. We have policy makers, we have government officials, we have we are talking the legacy issue. Mm-hmm. But I don't know how much time we are taking to actually speak to the people who are supposed to be delivering the universal healthcare that we are supposed to be consuming. Mm-hmm. And that now brings me to the issue of cancer. When you think, one of the things that one of those doctors told me is that NHIF pays 10 billion shillings to India. Mm-hmm. This is a national hospital insurance fund. Right. And the question was, if we thought about investing that money, because that's government funds, and we thought, now that's beyond what we are paying from fundraising and the private funds that we actually take into India.
Yes.
And the question was, if we thought about taking that cash mm-hmm. and investing it, now that we have identified the fact that cancer is becoming a problem. I remember several years ago, a couple of decades ago, when HIV was what we thought was a monster, and the entire government system just focused on getting people educated, getting people to know what they're supposed to do. I mean, we had a lot of conversations about abstinence, about what to do, about, you know, there was a lot of conversation about how to keep yourself away from it and what how to manage it if you do get it. Mm-hmm. Now, we are not seeing that kind of concerted effort, the issue of cancer, despite the fact that we're all talking about it. I do not know anybody who does not know somebody who is suffering from cancer,
yeah.
whether it's a relative or yeah. themselves or somebody close or a friend. Mm-hmm. So we do need, and as Mheshimiwa has said about what Mheshimiwa Waruhuru brought to Parliament, we do need as a country to accept that we have a massive problem with cancer. And then what do you do with it? You now focus your attention. Mm-hmm. The nation focuses attention. We look at, if we know that if it's discovered in stage one and stage two, it's easier to treat, it's easier to handle, it's cheaper, yeah, then what we should be doing is investing money to make sure we can catch it at that. We should be investing money in educating people to just keep going for screening. Because right. now people are finding it, when it puts you down, that's when you discover that you have it.
Great.
I think the government of Kenya has not done enough when it comes to matters of cancer. Mm-hmm. And as my colleagues clearly put it, I remember the times of HIV/AIDS. It had been declared a national disaster.
Yep.
We had a body, the National AIDS Control Council, which mm-hmm. was just created for purposes of managing HIV/AIDS. Mm-hmm. And we had a lot of VCTs, the voluntary counseling and testing.
Right.
All these were being put in place to manage HIV/AIDS, and we had issues of stigma, we had prevention of mother-to-child transmissions. Mm-hmm. I think there was also a lot of global fund that was coming here in Kenya mm-hmm. towards management of HIV/AIDS. Mm-hmm. I think it's the highest time the government must declare this as a national disaster and put mechanisms in place. For instance, when it comes to specializations, mm-hmm. I don't think we have enough doctors here who are experts when it comes to management of cancer. Mm-hmm. We have very few oncologists,
right.
the pathologists who are relevant when it comes to management of this case. So I think it's the highest time the government should also try to source for scholarships so that the medical doctors can go further for specialization mm-hmm. in terms of managing of these cancer cases. We saw Cuban doctors. Some of the Cuban doctors that came to this country, I saw some were oncologists. Mm-hmm. And right now, because cancer is now almost among the top killers in this country,
it's top three.
And the economic burden, mm-hmm. I think the government should focus heavily. And these exchange programs, I was in India, and the medical tourism in India is fantastic. Mm-hmm. So let's have even more doctors to be able to go to India for purposes of benchmarking,
yes.
study tours, so that they can be able to have this technology transfer, mm-hmm. so that when they come here, they can be able to manage these cases as they are presented.
I just wanted to add one more thing on that issue
as
we fight. Yes, finally. I think one of the things that we need to talk about also is the stigma that goes with it.
Mm.
And I think the awareness would help this. A lot of people look at cancer, the symptoms seem to mirror other diseases, and sometimes that stigma and self-denial becomes part of the problem before you actually get help. So it's need to deal with the stigma. And lastly, there's the question of the mental health. Chemotherapy is devastating. Mm-hmm. I can tell you from somebody whose father is fighting cancer, you need a lot of mental health and you need a lot of family support to get through it.
All right, and I hope you can make use of your great suggestions, because you're in positions of influence through Parliament and the influence that you can have on the government.